Good evening and welcome to the wonderful world of animation on our inaugural Facebook Live event, A Night with Belle. We thank you all for joining us this evening and we hope you enjoy what we have in store for you. First, we'd like to start with a little video presentation of our special guest. So sit back and enjoy, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.
Little town, it's a quiet village. Every day, like the one before.
I'm Paige O'Hara. I'm the voice of Belle. And I'm here today to talk about how having the opportunity to be in Beauty and the Beast 25 years ago was really a dream come true for me. I was actually born in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and I had this bug to perform and act and sing from the time I was 3 years old. That's me. My mother, I don't know what she was thinking, cutting those bangs short. I grew up around the house singing with my mom. My mom would play Judy Garland a lot, and I sang with her in all the show albums, you know, and stuff like that. But I didn't realize that I was actually pretty good at it until I was around 12 years old. I entered this talent competition, and everyone said, "Why aren't you singing? You have this big, beautiful voice."
There goes the baker with his tray, like always, the same old bread and rolls to sell.
In a lot of ways, it was like Belle, because I was kind of the oddball. I was into theater, which was not the cool thing. I was into Gershwin and Rodgers and Hammerstein, and my friends were into Led Zeppelin. I went to New York when I was 17, and just had all this kind of positivity and ignorance, really, you know, and what I was going to face. It was hard. I mean, I lived long periods of time on peanut butter and rice, you know? Painting and artwork has always been my second favorite thing to singing and acting. And when I had periods of time when I wasn't working, it was sort of my creative outlet. I would paint at night, watercolors. I'd sell my little watercolors on the street. My favorite spot was 84th Street, Broadway. And I would clean apartments, and that would pay for my rent and going to acting class and studying with Liz Howard, who was my voice teacher.
Waking up to say.
Oh, wow. Oh my God, Kai, that's good. That is wonderful.
Oh,
oh my gosh, here I'm supposed to be a coach and I have nothing to tell her to do. She's perfect.
One of the greatest blessings with playing Belle is that there's so much that I can do in the community art scene.
Just recently, I had the opportunity to visit a local theater company.
I'm excited for your Beauty and the Beast.
So are we.
Well, you're the original Belle.
Yeah.
How has it changed your life?
It totally changed my life. You know, I was working in New York in the Broadway theater, and my first Broadway lady role was in Showboat with the legendary Donald O'Connor, and I played Ellie Mae Chipley. Being your first Broadway role, you know, you'll never forget that. This was in the New York Times when Showboat opened. There's Donald O'Connor. And there's me dancing up a storm as Ellie Mae Chipley. I used to kick really high. I still kick really high, but I really kicked high then. I've always loved and cherished my theatrical career. I performed in so many different musicals on Broadway, and I played some wonderful roles like Fantine in Les Mis and the lead in South Pacific. And I got to playing Judy Garland in a musical. Oh, so many great memories. I heard about Beauty and the Beast, the auditions coming up, and I'd already been a huge fan of Howard Ashman and Alan Menken. I got the audition, and I had a feeling I'd have a callback, which I did. We went through 5 auditions. I was getting kind of excited because I knew I was in the mix, you know. And I'm telling, at that time, my fiancé, Michael, who's my husband, I said, "This is my job. I know it." And he's like, "You never do that. You never say you're gonna get a job." I really felt that way. I felt like I was born to play this part. And I finally got a call saying, "I got the job." Oh my gosh! I just started jumping up and down and screaming and laughing and crying. And the week that I got Belle, Michael had proposed to me the day before. Next day I get Belle. I was sort of on cloud 9.
2210, take 1.
I got a new book. Papa, do you have any idea?
what you were in for when you were in that recording studio.
I realized how challenging voiceover acting is. It's a different kind of beast, shall we say, when you're doing 8 shows a week and you're having to project to the balcony. Mm-hmm. In fact, that was a problem for me at first when I was recording, because I was talking and singing so loud. And Howard Ashman, I remember the first day, okay, Ethel Merman, no, cut.
Please, Gaston, I can't. I have to get home to help my father. Oh, that was good. Can you do this again?
Other than my voice, I think that I brought a sense of humor, certainly physically, the quirky, funny faces and stuff I would make. I had long brown hair at the time, and I always had the bangs in my eyes, and that one piece, when I was recording, I kept pushing away, and next thing I know, they've animated it. When I saw it the first time, I was like, that's so weird. I mean, she's me, you know? Younger me, but me.
I want excitement and adventure in my life. And I want someone to share it with.
I worked on and off for 2 years, but the film took 4 years to make. What people don't realize is that I recorded in the very first day the entire movie. Then we go back and they'd take parts of it and they'd rewrite it. And then I'd go away and I was doing Anything Goes, Reno and Anything Goes. Mm-hmm. A few months later, I'd go back in and then they'd change it.
There must be more than this provincial life.
Working with Alan and Howard Ashman was really a dream come true. Howard told me that he was a huge fan of my Showboat recording. So he sort of had a little fondness for my voice beforehand. So that was kind of nice.
Quiet. I think the quiet, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's got the same value, but it doesn't have the little turnout.
Yeah. When we started working on Beauty and the Beast, Howard knew that this was his final project, and he was very sick. He was able to be with us for the first year and a half in the studio, directing us high energy, I mean, amazing energy. Because it was his last project, I think there was an extra special part of Howard Ashman in that film that would be his legacy forever, and he knew that. Consequently, he was a stickler to every single detail of every aspect of the film, and everyone respected that and listened to him. I just wish I could just look at Howard and tell him, thank you for all that you've done. You've brought animation and musicals back to Disney. They're gonna affect children's lives forever. The truth was, he was the film. He saw it in his heart, in his mind. It was his vision. And I think he knew exactly how it came out. Being in Beauty and the Beast, in a film that's going to be around long after I'm gone, changes my life forever. It opened doors to me where I can perform for charities and raise money for children. I would never be able to do that before. We have a soft spot for children. We weren't able to have children of our own. So I kind of adopt all the kids that are fans of Beauty and the Beast that I meet all over the world. This is the Grammy for Best Children's Album of Beauty and the Beast, which was very special. And here's our gold award for the original album. And then a year or so later, platinum. One thing I really loved is that after Beauty and the Beast, all the princesses that were existing, we'd be invited to sing with these big orchestras for the premieres of other films. And also my husband and I were invited to go to do a 26-city tour in Japan with the Tokyo Philharmonic, doing live performance of Beauty and the Beast in concert. And Michael played Beast and Gaston. That was a dream come true. This is actually something I'm very proud of. I sang for Bill Clinton's first inauguration, and they gave me this award afterwards. That was kind of a fun night. How I got involved with Disney Fine Art was I was asked to be in an event that Rodel, one of the most famous Disney artists, was performing at. He was painting Beauty and the Beast that night, and he said, you know, I know that you paint, Paige. Why don't you bring one of your Belle paintings? Let's see what happens. And Michael Young, who was president of Collector's Editions, happened to be there that night. He said, you know what? I want to sign you for Disney, which was a great, great blessing. And of course, the main event, my Disney Legend Award. It's really heavy. Boy, becoming a Disney legend. Wow. You know, doesn't get any better than that. Most of all, it's all about the fans. You know, without you, none of this would happen. There have only been in history about 200 Disney legends that have been given that award, and it's something that I will cherish forever. I kind of thought I was too young to be a Disney legend. My husband and I moved to Las Vegas. I was doing the Rockette show to guest star, and we fully anticipated it was going 6 months. You know, we're gonna rent a house and back to New York. Well, 6 months turned to years because Broadway came to Las Vegas. I've been very involved with the arts in Las Vegas. A lot of children need the exposure to the arts, and I want to make sure that every opportunity to understand and learn about the arts is at their hand, be able to have that chance. The kids sometimes, though, the little ones especially, they expect the animated character, and they see me, older Belle. And, you know, it's like kind of quizzical, you know, and then I'll say, come here, close your eyes, and I'll either sing a little song or I'll say something like, Gaston, you are positively primeval.
Gaston, you are positively primeval.
And they'll go, hmm? More, you're Belle. And then all of a sudden, I'm ageless. It doesn't matter how old I am, I'm Belle. It was just so wonderful to be able to talk to them and work with the theater. It was a lot of fun. Being the voice of Belle made me look at my life a little differently. It's overwhelming and humbling at the same time.
We hope you enjoyed that little video presentation. We have a fun and filled evening for you tonight. It's going to start with a little informal gathering, learning about our special guest. You'll be able to ask questions through our Facebook Live. We'll then take about a 5-minute break to reset. And then comes the fun part of the evening where we'll be featuring artwork and other collectibles related to Beauty and the Beast. There's some really special pieces, and we also have 2 contest winners to announce. So now I'd like to introduce our guest of the evening, Disney legend, artist, singer, incredibly wonderful person, and somebody I'm proud to call a good friend, Miss Paige O'Hara. Welcome, Paige.
Hey, thank you. Great to be here. Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming. And please meet my husband, Michael Piontek. Also, a Broadway actor.
Is that right?
My husband actually played the Beast in the Broadway version, so it's kind of all in the family.
All in the family.
In the Los Angeles production.
Yeah. Hi, guys. How are you doing? Thanks for joining us this evening. When we, Paige and I, do these things quite a bit, actually, it's usually with a live audience, so this is a little different for us. But what we do is we just talk. That's kind of what we try to do. So we're going to talk about like some of the stuff that came up in the video and in the you guys just watched, and then expand on some of those ideas and stories, and hopefully we'll be able to interact with some of your questions as we go through here. That's why these glasses are hanging here. And then, you know, we'll see where we go. We have about 45 minutes to chat, so I'm gonna go ahead and get started. So Paige O'Hara, Florida girl. That was quite the little Always Belle little video. That was like a 12-minute like thing. How did that come to be? I mean, that's not just something that, you know, pops up suddenly and they go, hey, let's, you know, I mean, it's complicated.
It was kind of crazy. David Jessen from Disney, who I worked with previously on Peter Pan when we did the Neverland song of Richard Sherman's.
Okay, they don't know that, so yeah. Go ahead.
Peter Pan, yes.
David Jessen worked for Walt Disney, and he was the president in charge of a lot of the bonus footage that everybody was doing for the releases of all the DVDs. When they would re-release something, they would always put bonus footage on, and that was David's job. So.
And actually, I thought that was going to be like a few-hour job, whatever, just go there, sing it, with
right, sure it
would be over with, and then it turned out to be a full set.
Yeah, you got an email, right? We got an email that you know, said, hey, we found this trunk song, Richard Sherman wanted you to sing it with him.
Yes.
And so
down the lyric, he wrote this gorgeous melody.
What was the name of it?
Nevermind. And it's one of the most beautiful songs, honestly, I've ever heard.
Mm.
I thought I was just gonna go in and record it and it would be real quick and in and out, but
and headsets and you know, you'd be done and you'd walk out the door, right?
But it turned out full set of the darling bedroom, orchestra on stage, lights, camera, action, the gown, the old gown. I started singing it and recording in my beautiful gown that I bought, and I almost had a haircut. And they said, it's backless. We just don't think it's the right look.
Not Disney enough?
I don't know. I guess they want a little more maternal look. So David Jensen, he's such a variety. Wardrobe, they come over, and then they put this big old blue bow on the back of it, which actually turned out to look fantastic.
Okay.
So that was the first experience with David.
Right.
And then I get a call. We wanted to.
Richard was there too, right?
Richard was there the whole time. Absolutely.
Like a whole day shoot. And check it out.
It's really cool.
It's the bonus footage on Peter Pan re-release, check it out. It's really, really fun. Cool.
And then the call about Always Belle, I just thought, okay, they want to just interview me. You know, 25th anniversary is coming up. And next thing I know, I have a whole crew moving into my house for like 4 days, going through all my old scrapbooks and all this stuff. And,
that's right.
And I was like, David, is this like for an obituary or something?
Am I being written out? Is this for my, I'm no longer alive? This is my,
sign off? He said, no. We want this to be on the re-release of the 25th anniversary.
Okay.
And so we want to make it very special. And as you saw, David and that wonderful crew were very special.
Yeah, they did a great job. I mean, who else but Disney? Paige talked at one time about selling, her artwork on 84th and Broadway. So who else but Disney sends a film crew to New York City to shoot footage of moving past that park? I mean, they could have shot a still. They could have. No, they sent a whole film crew to New York.
I mean, they shot that was my corner back in the 70s.
And then we met him. Remember, he was in Las Vegas.
Yes.
We met him for cocktails, and we said, "What are you working on, right?" And it was the Little Mermaid.
I'm now painting all the princesses. And Jody, one of my dearest friends, is the voice of Ariel. I was working on painting Ariel, a couple different versions of it. I said, "Oh, this one I'm doing now." I showed him this picture of Ariel. I was working. He went, and like the light went off. He said, "All right, I think I'm going to make this happen." Long story short, he made the steelbook happen for me to do the artwork on it. I'm a little mermaid.
Right.
And that was a huge, huge honor for me.
Right. And then 25th anniversary, right?
Yeah.
It was oldest time. It was
oldest time. We're going to see in a little bit.
Yeah. Wow.
So thank you, David.
Thank you. The film, the little video you talked about, going to New York City at 17 and slaving to make a living. Was it really tough? Was it really really hard?
Of course.
Did you go literally like with a suitcase in your hand and $25 in your pocket, or how did that?
Well, it wasn't quite 25, maybe like 300 or something.
That's not far from 25.
But in 1975, I was doing a lot, and I had a girlfriend with me, Kathy Freed, and she was my big buddy that along with me for the ride.
So did you guys go together? Did you have a place set up to live?
Yeah, we set up and we lived together for a while. We went to a school together, and then I left that school and started studying with Joanna Marlin, and Kathy went back to Florida. I was kind of on my own. It was much harder once she left, but it was a learning experience. And people say, are you like Belle in any way? In that way, I was like Belle. I just wanted my adventure into being an actress and a singer, which I've been studying my whole life and dreaming of all my life. But I actually started acting, as you know, as a young age.
So what was your first like big break in New York? I mean, that was a big break.
Yeah, I cleaned apartments and I got smart and hired a bunch of actors and I managed them. It was really Gift of the Magi, Neil Henry's story. Ronnie Britton wrote the musical version of that, which was off Broadway at the Players Theater. Got a really good review from Clyde Barnes, thank God. And that was really because I just became equity. But the first really big thing
You had just become equity. That's hard. I mean, it's not so hard anymore, but that was really hard to do. How did you get your equity card?
Because of that. They wanted me to Ronnie had directed me in Funny Girl and in Cabaret. And
these were non-equity performances out of the city?
Yes.
Okay.
They were so much fun. Okay. And I did like a lead every 3 weeks. Only could do that in 19.
That's a lot of work.
I did Kiss Me Kate the first week. Then I did the lead of Funny Girl the second week. And the third week I did Sally and Cabaret. By the end, that was like really.
Well, as long as they're small, not challenging roles.
Oh, yeah. Okay. But it was because of him and got to have him Equity Library Theater back in the day.
Right.
All the casting people, they just would go to see who's cast and whatever musical is playing there.
Right.
And Company happened, and I got the role of Marta, the one who sings with 100 people, and it was kind of a fit like a glove. They let me do my crazy character stuff, and kind of like just like Annie Hall and singing with 100 people. And The New York Times said her voice will take her part. So that was
they were right.
But to me, the biggest break was William Hammerstein directing the revival of Oklahoma, which I was offered the national tour. And because I didn't give credit, so I didn't give off public credit. And so that was a real big deal doing it all in one night.
So William Hammerstein, Oscar's
eldest son.
Eldest son.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. And Agnes Bill was still alive, so she was still supervising the dance.
Wow. Yeah, these are theater names that,
And Jay Blackton, who's the original conductor, was conducting it.
Wow.
In fact, they said they had never done this before, but in Britain, Oscar did all these encores for I Can't Say No.
Mm.
And I guess that they had been done a few times in the original, but it was pretty much written for me to do it every night. The show started getting longer and I stopped doing it. I didn't think the audience would be crazy and do one instead of three.
Okay.
So okay. That was it. And then, of course, Showboat was, Bill Hammerstein was part of the.
Yeah, so what was that like? What was that audition? That's your first big Broadway show.
Oddly enough, Durkin, I got really lucky. A dear friend, Alex Corey, was playing it on the national tour. We had a lot of chicken. It was with Donald O'Connor, and it was amazing. Paul Keith was the comedy part of Ron Reynolds. It was an amazing cast. And my friend just said she didn't like the part, and she didn't want to do it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And Alex, she did a lot of great character parts, and she was moving over to the leading lady category, and I loved playing the comedy parts. And she kind of recommended me, and then I auditioned with a bunch of other people, but I ended up getting it, and I'm loving it.
So what was your opening night on Broadway like? Was it like everything that you had dreamed it would be? I mean, was it like, we dream about opening on Broadway?
It was everything and more.
Yeah?
Oh my gosh. Look at the piece. One of the greatest shows ever written, musicals ever written.
Yeah.
You just played the material honestly and it's been.
Yeah.
And
you and Donald got to be buds?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah, Donald. Man, Donald O'Connor, there was one laugh I wasn't getting. And I said, Donald, what's wrong? He said, everything you're doing is right. It's very organic. It's very real. But this particular laugh is a 1-2-3 punch. And it literally was a technical, physical shtick, 1-2-3 punch. And I got the laugh every night ever since. After that.
Yeah, you saw
from the greatest,
The New York Times obviously was favorable to that show. And
yes.
We saw a photo in that little video of the of your Hirschfeld. Hirschfeld is
my dancing. I could kick high. I wasn't a great dancer.
Yeah,
I was funny and I could kick high. Paul Keith was one of the best comedians actors in New York.
Ever. Yeah, Hirschfeld was a caricaturist who did all of the Broadway shows, and who's no longer with us. So. Nice to
have a big deal.
Nice to have a Hirschfeld with you.
Very good.
So Showboat, and then John McGlynn. Let's talk about John McGlynn a little bit, because he was leads really to Beauty and the Beast in a lot of ways.
John really helped change my career.
Who was John?
John was considered one of the greatest musical historians ever.
Okay.
In Broadway theater.
Okay.
And he worked closely on the restoration of Showboat. In fact, the only recording has the entire show of all the dialogue, songs, background music, dance music is from John McGlynn, which was a huge hit, won all kinds of awards, with EMI Records, and it starred Federica Estrada, Jerry Hagley.
Oh, tell that story about
Federica Estrada.
Tell that story. Come on.
She's one of the greatest mezzo sopranos ever in opera, in the world, ever.
Ever.
And always that ever. She was, of course, playing Magnolia, the beautiful leading lady soprano.
Right.
And John wanted her to stretch her horizons and play also the daughter, another part of the album. But the daughter, Kim, is the belter. And he wanted it belted, you know? And she's like, okay, I don't know how to sing it like that. And I was like, saying, Flip, just put it in the chest. You know, 10 minutes later, she's gone. Literally 10 minutes, she switches her voice. It's getting hotter in the north every day. It's getting hotter in the north every day.
So you took one of the greatest operatic sopranos in the world and had her belting.
I didn't do it, but I suggested that woman can sing anyway. I'm one of my biggest fans
all the time. All right, so John and you were buds.
Yeah.
And he ended up doing a bunch of...
He was the king of restoring all these old scores. And predominantly at that time, it was the Princess Theater shows. And we're talking pre-Showboat, turn of the century. Mm-hmm. Oh Boy, Oh Lady, there's Cat and Fiddle. And he would restore these and he would produce them and conduct them at Carnegie Hall, recital hall. And I was cast in two of the leads in those. And it was amazing because you had no microphones. It was just, the acoustics were so incredible. And he knew how to conduct the orchestra to accompany the singer. I got some great responses, but I found out years later that Howard Ashman was a fan of those and a fan of the Showboat recording. And I didn't find that out until we were in rehearsals and starting to film. So I think that, thanks to John, I think that I was a huge influence. That Howard knew what I did.
Did you do a production with Maureen McGovern
Oh, that was something different. That was Gershwin.
Oh.
They're getting your composers.
You're getting them mixed up. Sorry.
That's another story. We'll do that on the next one.
Okay.
But that's Gershwin. Michael Tilson Thomas. Another great story and a great conductor.
Okay, so you went to New York at 17, so 74, 75. So now, you've been in New York for how long now, about?
I've been here for 7 years.
Okay.
I mean, I was in my 24.
So you were reading the New York Times one day and something came up that piqued your interest?
Well,
I mean,
first, before that, I've been a Disney freak my whole life.
Okay.
Literally, when I was unemployed in New York and really depressed, I always go to a double feature on Disney on Saturday. My friend's Donna Bruce, but he's like, that was just what we did.
Okay.
And I saw Little Mermaid and was absolutely floored at, like everyone else, and how brilliant it was.
Yeah.
And I was so happy for Jody because I knew Jody and Ray.
Yeah, you guys were like,
So I saw that they're doing Little Mermaid and I just told the agent, please, you have to get me in an audition. They got me an audition and I went in and I was so shocked. We're just Disney, this huge company, right? And there's this little tape recorder on the table, this little cassette player. They're like, oh, really? Really? So I sang my song, and, you know, Albert Tavares, God bless him, he said, you're going to be called back. So he kind of gave me some advice. And that's the beginning of the multiple auditions.
Okay. And more and more people in the room each time you went back.
Every time. Yes.
The cassette player for the younger generation, that cassette player was a little piece of tape, two things that roll around that we used to thrive on, live on, you know, they were called Walkmans back in those days. They wanted to hear what you sounded like.
Yeah,
right? And so they would take the tape and listen, right?
Exactly. But then after that, it was literally they were in the room and they closed their eyes. We had a black piano player from Calvin.
So did they actually, as the audition process moved on, and you went in initially and sang your own music, right?
I actually sang a song from Chess, How They Got My Heart, which is one of my ultimate favorite ballads.
Okay.
It just seemed, had so many acting levels to it that I thought it was the right one, and obviously it was. So.
Okay.
There would be more and more people, and I'd usually do the scene or the song that they wanted at the moment twice.
Mm-hmm.
I would do it first, and they would close their eyes and listen, and then the second time they'd watch me. And it was really interesting. It was a really amazing process.
So did they give you like the whole script as the thing was on? They gave
you the song and some sides.
Some sides.
I didn't know what the whole script was.
Did you read with like Albert, the casting person? Or did they
no.
Have, did they pair they you
had
up
a
with different? Oh, they had a reader.
Okay. We just sat in the corner.
Okay.
So, but it was, amazing.
So how many times over how long do you think that it
over the years I've tried to recollect, and sometimes I think it was 5, but other times I think it was 7 auditions. I can't remember. It was a lot. I just remember at the last one, everyone was there. And I left the audition, went to my apartment, and as soon as I closed the door, my answering machine, which we had back then, said, "Hey, Paige, it's David. We got to get together for keys for Beauty and the Beast."
That's how you found out you got it.
That's how I found out.
Nice.
My agent was like, we couldn't get through to me. We had, like, just getting a busy signal.
Nice.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Okay. So can we need to talk a little louder? Yeah, a little louder.
Okay.
And I'm seeing some of these questions popping up on the screen here, guys, but we have a lag with this. So by the time I see the question, I'm not sure where we are. So is it easier to act or easier to paint?
I'll talk louder. That's been fun. Okay, thank you. Okay.
Is it easier to act or is it easier to paint?
Act.
That's not the
not even close. Not even close. Painting is like it's so rewarding, but it's also incredibly challenging and frustrating at times. But also my natural instinct was acting from the time I was little. And painting, I just admired artists so much, and my stepdad was an artist and architect, and I just wanted to be able to create that. I love Sargent and Turner and Da Vinci, and I love all of the impressionists.
Mm.
So I would try and copy them and stuff. And so that was the life.
So you got cast, and then how long before you started rehearsing, and how did that go? What's it like the first day of recording? You showed up, and was that in New York or was that
in
LA?
It was in New York.
Was it within like a week or a month? Or Jody had to wait like a year, didn't she?
She did. It was really quickly. It was within a couple of weeks. Within a couple of weeks, it was me by myself that day with the directors, Kirk and Gary, and Alan and Howard, and all of them were there.
Alan and Howard were there as well.
Absolutely.
I didn't realize on the first day.
Yeah, Alan didn't stay because he had another gig he had to do, but Howard stayed through all the sessions. And I remember when I first started reading the lines, I could see Howard in the booth behind the glass. He's like, no. He said, "What are you doing?
What are you doing? Babe, stop.
To the balcony, okay?" And I said, "But I have to still ignore camera, small. Do it okay. Again. No. He comes out. He said, "Now what are you doing?" I said, I thought I should sound younger. He said, "No, Paige. We want you. We want your voice. We want Paige to come through this character. She is more of a mature kind of Disney heroine. She's an old soul. We love the warmth of your voice. So stop trying to do this other stuff and be yourself."
Okay.
And actually, that helped me a lot.
That was your battle in the whole process, wasn't it? I mean, that sounds so simple, just be yourself. But in reality, it's really, really hard. It's a very hard thing to do.
It was a very vulnerable position.
Yeah.
But it was something that was incredibly, it kind of changed my whole take on acting, actually.
Mm-hmm.
I really realized that there's so much more I can draw on for myself. And I tended to lean towards the comedy roles. I didn't want to do anything serious.
Mm.
But there was that serious side to me, too, and that came through really well as well.
Mm.
It was really good. It didn't really come to, really didn't, my character not really hit like its stride until Robin Benson was hired. And that was a month later. They couldn't find the Beast.
So you went in, and I remember she came home the first day, and I was like, "So how'd it go today?" And she's like, "Well, I finished the whole film. I recorded the whole thing." And I was like, "What?
In one day you recorded the whole film?
Come on.
I was kidding.
You couldn't have stretched it out to like 2 or 3 days? Come on, stop it."
I was kidding, yeah, but I did do the whole script because they wanted to hear the through line of it, what it was like. But,
yeah. But
of course, 2 years later, I was still recording.
Right. But
when Robbie came in, it was just like I've known him my whole life. It was like I thought he was my brother. It was so strange, and he felt the same way about me. And I asked if we could record together, and they never let you do that because it's technically complicated, and it's also more expensive because there are a lot more errors that happen. But they said yes. I couldn't believe it.
Yeah.
And so Robbie and I could act.
Was that in New York that he first started?
Yes,
it was in New York. You were doing almost most of your recording.
Most of the acting was done in New York, and the music back and forth.
Yeah.
And yeah, I'm depending on their schedules because it was over 2 years. But,
yeah.
So, but it was Robbie was. I think Robbie's the whole key to the success of the film, other than the fact that it was our national vision. We all follow what Howard wanted in this. And there were times in the beginning when we were like straying here and there, and he would say, focus, please listen to me. He knew this was his last film.
Mm-hmm.
And his heart, he felt so.
Nobody else knew that though, right?
Nobody knew this
at
all.
Well, I'm sure Alan did, and probably some of the Disney execs knew. I mean, but you guys were sheltered from all that, right? Really?
I knew that's another story I wrote about that time. But,
yeah.
But in retrospect, some of the things he said had a whole new meaning after he died.
Mm-hmm.
Of how he saw the beast and he saw a lot of these characters. He saw there was part of Howard that was Belle, there was part of him that was Beast. Now I understand some of the direction he was giving me with Kirk and Gary.
Mm-hmm.
And I followed it. But back to the point of the Howard story, follow your vision. If you went along for the ride, you're going to learn a lot, but it's going to be amazing, right? So that's what happened, and I think that's really, he put all the right people together and directed us in the right way. I'm talking animators, musicians, everyone, actors. That's what happened.
So what was it? I mean, and a lot of people don't know, but they have, they videotaped all of the vocal recording sessions.
Yes.
And then they would send those tapes to the animators, and the animators would study those tapes.
Yes.
And you know, that's the brilliance of Disney animation, right?
Actors with their pencils.
Right. I mean, they are able to capture expressions and mannerisms and you know,
I was kind of confused at first. I remember on the lunch break saying that, asking Don Hahn, I said, why are those people there? Why are they, all these things happening? Don Hahn said, explained it to me. I was like, okay, I'm an idiot. I should have said that. Don Hahn, of course, was the smartest man on the face of the earth.
Well,
is the smartest man on the face of the earth. But it was kind of like things like you see the stuff on Always Belle. That day I knew I was going to be photographed, so my mother made me like curl my hair.
Yeah, you guys look kind of
pageant.
You and Robbie were very clean and you know.
Why did I do that? Because normally when we record, we had stringy hair and a ball cap, you know. My hair was in my eye, and they, of course, put that on. And all these little quirks that we have.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what like you told? It went on for almost 2 years, right? Redo. Tell me the story about the wolf scene. That was in LA, right? And
that
did they tell you?
That is the only scene that they had me loop, meaning the wolves were done first and then I.
So the animation was finished.
It was switched around.
Okay.
That was the only scene where the animation happened before I recorded it.
Did they hand you a script with a bunch of
oohs
and No? No script. Okay, so
no.
How did that happen?
Sit in the theater, Don said, react naturally.
Really?
And it scared me. I was terrified.
So, all of those.
And I was saying to them, how are the little kids going to handle this? I can't handle it. It was so realistic. It was crazy. And Don said, we were kind of hoping you'd scream. And I said, but when I tried to scream, I can't because I'm too scared to scream. And actually, I tried to do a couple of them and they came off fake. So they ended up doing what my natural first take was.
Wow.
Which was like, you try to scream, but you can't get it out.
Right.
Like,
and what was the other story about the death scene? Wasn't there a story about the death scene when you were recording
it? Big deal about this.
Tell that story.
Robbie and I were doing the death scene together, whatever. And they turned down all the lights in the studio, down low, you know, so I feel the darkness, you know, with what's going on, with it's raining.
It's pretty way down. It's pretty dark. Right. Make the mood.
Yes.
Okay. So, and Robbie was literally laying there on the floor.
No.
So that's not true.
But you know what?
I figured Robbie would have jumped in there and just, okay, I'm dying. Okay.
I still had the money. I had the hair.
Okay.
So I did the scene, whatever, and
which is a pretty emotional scene.
Yeah,
for
Belle. Yeah, as you know.
Okay, it's a pretty emotional scene.
They come back home. Are you okay? I said, what do you mean? You're really crying. I said, well, acting. Hello.
That's what you hired me to do.
Exactly. Yes, I did really cry because okay. I was feeling the scene.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
All right. Yeah, I know. I'm trying to. But yeah. So you worked on it for almost. What is your favorite painting that you have done, Lauren? I think I know who you are, Lauren.
Hi, Lauren.
What is your favorite painting that you have done? Your favorite one.
Is it my favorite? Well, there's a couple of them, but. Oh, how do I do that?
I don't know. That's like your favorite child. Which is your favorite child? That's a hard question, Lauren. Just letting you know. She'll think about that. She'll get back to you later on that. Okay. So you worked for 2 years on this film, and you never saw anything other than drawings or.
We would see little snippets, but nothing that you could really tell.
And so what was the first time you saw like the film in its entirety, kind of? And realized.
Actually,
what was that?
In Bingham Center, the unfinished version. And that was in front of all the New York critics at Bingham Center. And I thought Don Hahn and Jeffrey Castle were going to have a hard time.
Right. Unfinished version, unfinished. Meaning that it,
some of it was fully animated. Right. Some of it was
some
like
of it
still
was
drawings.
Line drawings.
Line drawings
and, yeah.
But of course, all the music and dialogue was there. But I remember the opening scene.
So had that ever been done before?
No. In fact, it was. A lot of people thought it was very dangerous that it could ruin the whole thing. But Disney Studios, famous Disney Studios, they said, no, we're going to take that chance. It's a work of art. We want people to understand the process of how difficult animated films are to make. And we think the average person, they don't understand the amount of work that goes into it. And they're absolutely right. It was the smartest move they could make. Me knowing the New York critics, at the end of this movie, the entire audience. A 10-minute standing ovation, but after the first song, I should tell you, and there again, they clapped after each song.
It did. So
yeah, so it was like a Broadway show.
Like a Broadway show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then at the end, we knew we put up on stage, and it was great. I think we're looking at something, a question on the screen.
Yeah, and again, there's a lag here, so I'm not sure. But were you asked to do a cameo in the live-action Beauty and the Beast?
No, I was just thrilled to send messages. To Emma through Don Hahn and giving her support. And I thought she was perfect casting. And Michael and I got to be there opening night of the live action, and that was really cool to get to meet them all in person, especially meet Emma. That was a wonderful moment.
And so, fast forward, the film was received so well there. Fast forward to opening night. Where was opening night and what was that? What was that like?
It was in Orlando, and I could not believe it. It was just an amazing night. That was
didn't they turn the entire section of the park into the village? Isn't that what they did?
Yeah, they did.
They like walked through Belle.
It was a whole section of the park that was the village. It was unbelievable. Uh-huh. I was so excited. I had my family with me, except for my mom, who couldn't. She was too sick to come. Mm. But my dad and my brothers and sisters, my friends were there. Of course, you were there. It was a kind of a really cool thing. I'll tell you real quickly. Disney Studios was incredibly generous to me that since my mom couldn't drive far or whatever, we lived in Fort Lauderdale, so they set up a special screening for my mom and my friend Michael Scott Gregory, who was really sick at that time. The two of them to come see it in Hollywood, Florida, so we did that too. So I kind of had two openings. That was really cool.
So was that like the first time you saw it in all its real full-on glory?
Yes.
Yeah.
Opening night.
And then they did a bunch of press stuff.
A lot of different openings in different cities.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. All right. And so what was, you talk about it, you know, kind of changing your life. In what ways? I mean, you talk about, like, let's, you were in Atlanta doing a production of South Pacific, right?
I know a story you're talking about. It was with Robert Goulet, and I met one of my best friends of my life, Ron Guarneri.
Mm-hmm.
He's still, he's like my brother.
This was not long after the film had opened, correct?
A couple years. I did the tour of South Pacific in Australia for a year and a half.
Right.
A couple people And then Robert Goulet was doing a tour in the States, and I was asked to do Nellie and that. And I remember during the rehearsal week, there's all over the news the story of this little girl who just went through a really bad accident. And I was just saying to Ron, I said, what can we do? He says, we go, call up Disney and ask. So I literally called up Howard Green at Disney.
Howard Green,
who everyone loves. And I told him what had happened to his child. He said, you know what? Go to the Disney store, fire whatever you think that she would like to have. And I was like, see, that's the power of the princess, the power of Disney.
The power of the princess.
Yeah, things like that, you know.
So you went on to do like a lot of stuff with Ronald McDonald House. Make a wish
Foundation. Yeah. It was fun friends, but my personal favorite is Give Kids the World, which is in Orlando. Mm-hmm. And I have a very big soft spot for Give Kids the World. Google it if you don't know what it is. It's pretty amazing what they do.
Okay. So Disney, well, now we're really jumping forward. I know, we have like 10 minutes more and then we're
okay.
Like,
okay.
Cut. You know.
So pick your favorite story.
I am. So we're going to talk about some of your art just a little bit.
Yes,
Disney fine art. So you were, when I met Paige, I helped her move into this apartment. And she had a bunch of stuff shoved in the storage space. And I pulled it out with some artwork. And I said, who painted these? She said, oh, I did. They're terrible. And they were like, not terrible. They were really good. So later on, when we went to LA for me to do Phantom, she had some free time on her hands. So I said, why don't you start painting? Right? And so she did. And we did an event where a belle showed up. And you met Michael Young. And then what happened after we met Michael Young? And your little piece sold that.
I know. That was crazy. I did a Belle by Belle walking down the street. And then Bonnell's event, where Belle Gonzalez's event. And And Troy Carlson,
age 9, up in Sacramento.
Yeah, he put it together. I mean, yeah. It kind of changed my life.
Yeah.
Kind of went to Troy and to Rebel.
Yeah.
It sold, and that night Michael Young said, we want you to sign it.
Well, he didn't say that.
Oh, he did say that to me.
He didn't say that to me.
We were out in this.
Boy, I wish I had known he said that. It would have saved me a lot of work. I thought he said, why don't you do 5 or 6 paintings and then bring them to California?
He told me we want to sign you. But I also did my homework after that, and I looked at the artists that they had. And I did what he asked. Michael and I put a bunch of them in the car, and we drove there. And as soon as I walked in to Disney Fine Art, and I see this Tony Palooza on the wall, I said, Michael, pack up our paintings.
Put the paintings in the car. We are going home, man. We are not doing that.
Questions.
All right, let me see. You are so similar to the Paige paintings. Did you ever get to meet Judy or her daughter? I'm assuming that means Judy Garland.
Of course, yeah, my fans know. You all know how much I admired and tried to copy Judy Garland when I was little. I got to meet Lorna and Liza. I never got to meet Judy, unfortunately, but adore Lorna and adore Liza. What was your
favorite part of Beauty and the Beast?
The something there, the snow thing. We talked about it, the directors and Howard, and that moment when she's trying to get the beast to feed the little bird, and the beast is frustrated, and then he puts out his paw, and the bird jumps on his paw, and that's the first time Belle just turns around and touches him and runs behind the tree, and that's the moment her heart is pounding out of her chest, and she realized I'm in love with this beast. That's the moment she realized she's in love. So that's my favorite, and that's also Howard's last song that he wrote.
So when now I feel like we're rushing. Okay, so when I'll read the questions. a princess you love to paint besides Belle.
Oh, I love all of them. I love Rapunzel, which is really popular. I love Mandy Moore. I love Linda Larkin, Jasmine. I love Jenny Vincent. I love all of them. And I love also painting Princess and the Frog.
Tiana. Didn't you do at D23, the princesses were getting together?
Yes, and they're all girlfriends of mine. So we kind of worked it out with Disney character voices, right? So we don't bring them in. So I got to give an original to each of them. And that was kind of cool. And I've since then gotten to meet Ali E, and I haven't done one for her. I need to do. I do have a Moana here tonight to show you, though. It's my first Moana that I've done.
Cool. Okay. What was it like working with Angela Lansbury? How much time do we have?
That's an hour right there.
We have. Yeah, that's a loaded question.
I will
right
give the quickest answer. And okay. Try to include everything.
Okay.
Preface it to say, when I went to New York, I was 18, 17, she's starring in Gypsy on Broadway, Mama Rose. I would sneak in at intermission because I couldn't afford a ticket, and watch the second act several times, watch her stop the show every night singing Roses during her Rose. I mean, all the roses are great. Now, you know, there's Berman, there's all of them. But she was different. She was more likable as Mama Rose. And later, when I got to meet her with Beauty and the Beast, we talked about it, and I said, it's almost as if you were like this immature child and Louise was the grown up. She said, you've got it exactly right.
Tell the story about the Oscars.
Angie. Well, I have to tell you too about the recording though first.
Oh, okay, right. Like I said, that's a loaded question. There's like 14 things we could talk about. We'll do two or three.
The day that we recorded with the full orchestra.
Right, in New York City.
Yes. Symphony. Right. We had Broadway stars singing the chorus that were all in this huge room.
Right.
And Angela came in and she'd been up all night. Her flight had been canceled, had no sleep. And Don Horn said, well, why don't we just schedule you for tomorrow? She said, no, I'll be okay. I'll do it. You know, and put it in perspective, you know, she wasn't that young. I mean, she was like my, I'm the same age she was, 66 when she was playing with the spot. No sleep, whatever, you know, your voice, it's kind of hard to do that. Mm. And she got up in front of the microphone, and I'll be damned, she just got up there and sang, and there wasn't a dry eye in the whole room.
Mm.
She sang Beauty and the Beast, and it was a masterclass in acting.
Mm.
And that's the take of the movie.
Mm.
Skip over
to 25 years later, right?
Yeah, and then 25 years later, we were celebrating at Lincoln Center. She's 93 years old.
That Disney decided to circle back to Lincoln Center for the 25th anniversary, where it kind of all started with that. Showing of the unfinished version.
Right.
And they asked Angela.
Yeah, and we all came back, and then Alan wanted her to sing Beauty and the Beast as a finale of the event. And you know, she was a little nervous about it. We talked about it in the afternoon about the tempo. She wanted the tempo a little faster. And I was just saying, Angie, it's going to be brilliant, whatever you do. He's going to follow you. And she got up there, and there again, the whole audience is like holding up their phones and taping it, and people are sniffling in the audience, and there again, it was perfection at 93.
Right.
It was perfection.
Rest in peace, Angela. We miss you, and we love you, and you know, the reality is that now, you know, Paige is kind of the same age as Angela was when the film was started and the recording, which kind of puts it in a very different perspective, but she was one of the icons, and we will miss her greatly. There's a couple of other questions. Will you ever plan to go to Tokyo Disney? That's when we were over there.
Oh, Tokyo Disney. Michael and I were planning on it. We were over there.
We were there. We were trying to get there.
Right at 2020.
This was the event you did with Alan.
We were in Yokohama.
Yeah.
Right when the pandemic started. Yeah. And the Japanese were still, they were wearing masks already.
Yes, unbeknownst to Paige, I had set up for us to go there because the dark ride, Beauty and the Beast dark ride was getting ready to open.
Yeah.
We were going to go there.
And then
2 days before we got on the plane, you know, the producers called us and said, there's this little pandemic going on down here, and you guys still are coming, right? So,
well, we did, but then they made it clear we need to get back quickly and get stuff here. So, but we were planning, we will come back to Tokyo and to Disneyland. I can't wait. I want to see it so badly.
Can you speak more about your artistic inspirations and passion for art?
I guess probably the most emotional I get with art is when I look at originals of Joseph Mallard, William Turner, John Singer Sargent, and Leonardo da Vinci. Those three are the three that when I literally go to the museum and see them in person, I find myself bursting into tears. And it's tears of joy and just admiration. And When I was in New York, I went to the Metropolitan Museum and just walked around all the time. And I just, my father, Robert Hall, he was a great architect and great artist and kind of intimidating, actually. Mm. But he's the one that actually kind of, persuaded me to do this. And, and he said, if you can do the watercolor, you'll be fine with oils or whatever. And he was right. Watercolor is by far the hardest medium.
Can't fix it.
But I could literally go look at an art book of Turner and I'd be lost in it for hours. And it just takes me to a different, as Walt says, takes you to your happy place. That's what happens with a certain artist like Turner or something.
Mm. Okay. And Disney legend, Paige O'Hara, how does that happen? And what's that? How did you find out? And I mean, it doesn't happen every day, so what was that like?
Did you get a letter?
You got a letter from Michael.
Mr. Eisner sent a letter and said, I thought, really? I thought you had to be really old to be a legend. But I was
aren't actually, legends mostly dead?
No, but it was really amazing. I was on cloud nine, and I found out Linda and Jody and Nico were included, and Leia. It was all of us. And that was really kind of cool. But we were just going to be coming up and accepting our awards. And I said, aren't we going to sing? And they said, I don't think we can make that happen and get everybody to agree with it. So I kind of pushed that and made that happen for us to all sing that night. And that was a special night.
Now, what was that like? Was that just insanity?
It was.
Yeah.
But it was great.
You got to put your hands in cement and bronze several times now. Did you get to go to the studio to see your hands in legend? What's that like being in the lot on Disney? And
it was surreal.
So what do you think? You think you ever get a chance to write a memoir? Well, what happened? We just saw Jody Benson actually and read her book, and there's been some talk about that. So
I wrote the foreword to Jody's book, and she's like, you need to do this, Paige. I'm like, I just don't think I can. I don't know. I'm not ready yet. I am thinking about it though. I'll say that much.
Okay. You were so similar to the character Belle. Did the rest of the cast have similarities that showed up in their character?
Everybody did. Yeah, Jerry's so funny, like Lumiere and David Ogden Stiers with all of his ad libs. Most of them ended up in the movie. But Angela, of course, being the maternal, loving person, and Chip, he's my Bradley Pierce, and he was hysterical. The whole little thing with the bubbles in the cup was something we had. Everybody had their own little unique parts of themselves that came through the characters. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the genius of the casting people as well as Don Juan. Mm-hmm. Don Juan never takes enough credit. And I ask him,
Mr. Humble, Don Juan.
Yeah, no, yeah. See, what is Mr. Humble, of how you do this? He said, I put all the great people together.
Yeah.
It's a lot more than that.
Yeah, that's what he says. Oh, I just stay out of everybody's way. I hire good people and I leave them alone. Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about after the 25th anniversary, last 5 years, stuff coming up. What's going on in your life now? Obviously, you're doing a lot of painting. Is that becoming more of a full time thing for you?
It's painting is pretty much full time.
Yeah.
And now as you're seeing a little bit, I'm expanding with all the princesses and some lion king. I absolutely love lion king. But I also got a call not long ago about singing again.
For the anniversary, yeah. Talk
about next year's the 100th
anniversary.
For Walt starting the studio.
Yeah, Walt moved to Los Angeles in 1923.
Right.
So this is the anniversary for the 100th year. So they're going to do a bunch of big stuff.
And there's a song. I'm not going to give it away, but I start the song, and the song's going to be everywhere in all the parks next year. And all of the characters from the past 100 years are featured. So it's like an 8-minute song. But I got in the studio and sang again, and it felt really good.
And what's the kind of the premise of it? All of the animated characters jumping off the walls and coming to life and singing and carrying on in celebration of
the world.
Oops. You didn't hear that from me. Oops.
Yeah, well, It's going to be sensational. I'm just telling you. Okay. You have a real treat in store.
Yeah, it's going to be really fun.
Because all the great characters of the last 100 years.
It's going to be really fun. So, the upcoming Beauty and the Beast TV special starring, yeah, listen, it's out there. Everybody knows it's coming. Everybody knows you did a little cameo on it.
Let's well, now they
about,
know.
Let's
well,
talk about this a little bit. Let's talk about this a little bit now.
Okay.
Come on, give this guy some inside stuff, man.
Myself and two other people from the original movie are going to make little cameos on this incredible production with her. Gabby, Josh Groban, Joshua Henry, these incredible people, oh my God, and the great Shania Twain. It's just going to be an amazing event. I don't know what it's going to look like at the end because I was only there for one day. Mm. So I just saw some of the stuff they were doing artistically. So I can't wait to see it either. I don't know what it's going to look like. My only interaction I had was with her. Gabby is the most genuine, sweet person. I just fell in love with her the day that we spent.
It was like that with Emma too, wasn't it? When,
unfortunately, I didn't get to spend that kind of time.
Right, but I remember going. We went to the opening night. We went to the. And
well, these girls could be.
You were doing the big long red carpet thing, and Emma
they
came
could be
in
my
with
daughter,
her entourage.
Or my granddaughter. Right. Right. Emma could be my granddaughter. Emma was mom,
and somebody came over and said, hey, we want Paige, you want to meet Emma? And Paige was like, no, she's mom, she's crazy, yeah. And so what happened?
Well, Emma was adorable. Paige across the room and, came over and took my hand and included me in the evening.
And put you in with the rest of the cast for all the photos and
very
stuff.
Very sweet. Yeah. I felt very, very special.
Well, maybe that's what they look for, that quality in Belle, is that she's sweet and nice and all of those things. That's
kind of more than that, intelligent.
So we gotta wrap
Head
it up.
Strong.
We gotta
5 minutes.
Okay. Did you get to see any of the people doing the shows, the other Belles? Obviously. The Broadway,
of course, the Broadway,
and the parks as well, and Susan.
I love the ones in the park, but on the Broadway, Susan Egan.
You could boast about me a little bit for that Broadway.
My husband played opposite Susan Egan in the LA production as the Beast, and that was totally surreal sitting in the audience watching that. Susan's like little me. I feel kidding her about that.
Susan's like a little you.
She's littler than I am. She's
she is tight. Yes, she is.
Doll, a little friend, and she's amazing.
Yes.
Anyway, but it was really fun to watch it on stage. I really loved it.
We didn't even talk about that. But
and I got to say, too, getting to see Leroy Reeves play in the
New York.
He's an old friend of mine back in 1974.
Brilliant. How did that all come to be? I mean, the journey from the film to the concert to the Broadway show.
This is a very interesting story.
How did that all come to be?
Because Disney did not want to
do it. There was no such thing as Disney theatrical. It didn't exist. No. There was no such thing.
And Jeffrey kept asking Mr. Eisner to do it.
Jeffrey wanted to do
a stage version.
Because it is written like a Broadway show.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's absolutely written like a Broadway show.
The story.
Okay.
The true story.
She's talking quiet.
Okay, I'll talk louder. Mr. Cassenberg planned a wonderful birthday party for Mr. Eisner. And it was at the Waldorf Astoria in New York. And he had myself and Richard White, whole chorus, full orchestra, to do a mini concert version of Beauty and the Beast for his birthday present. And of course, little unknown people like Kathy Lee and Regis were there making the audience feel at home at the beginning of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that night, it was Mr. Eisner said, yes, you get your Broadway show, Jeffrey. Mm-hmm. And look what happened after that.
Yeah. And did they reach out to you? I mean, I know you had a decision to make, right?
I had a discussion with Jeffrey, and I had already signed to do South Pacific in Australia.
Right. Which was a huge production. They had just brought King and I over to Broadway, and it was a huge.
It was a role as being an R&H girl.
It was a role she was the right age for at the time.
And that's the key, the right age. I knew, I was in my late 30s by then, I knew I was really too old for the role to play on Broadway. I felt that I'd be criticized. In retrospect, of course I could have done it.
Yeah.
I was you know, I look young and everything. But yeah. I think it was not the right choice. The right choice was to go do that part in South Pacific and pursue the vision to create that one. That was what it was meant to be.
Yeah.
So that's how I feel.
Okay. And nobody knew how it was going to be, really. I mean, in retrospect, it's run for 20 years, you know, so it was a big hit. But
and there was a chance later, too. They had talked about me possibly doing it later in productions, but then Michael and I started fertility drugs and all that stuff. We were trying to get pregnant at the time.
Yeah.
I was really having a rough time with hormones and stuff. Yeah. So it just wasn't meant to be. But later, much later, of course, Michael and I, you know, we did it in concert with the Tokyo Philharmonic.
Right.
We toured 21 cities with Beauty and the Beast in concert and full orchestra. That was when I was meant to do Belle on stage with Michael in Japan.
So when you see Belle in the park, two children dressed as Belle, or when we're doing our fan events, what does that make you feel like?
I love it. I absolutely love it. And it's funny, you know, when I do the fan expos, whatever, and Jody does them with me, whatever, we keep, and Linda too, tissue on our table, because a lot of times they'll come up and people will share their experience of the film and they'll cry and, you know, hugs. And I just love hearing the stories and how important this movie was to so many people.
Mm. So if you had, obviously, as your perspective of this character changed over the years, I mean, has it sort of...
You know, everything changes 30 years later. You know, you're older, you're wiser, you know, and you see things in a different perspective and with a different kind of appreciation and gratitude.
Any concept when this ride started that 30 years later you'd still be sitting in front of Belle and going to the park and doing all these kinds of things? Yep. Any idea at all that this would happen?
I really did not.
Yeah.
You know, it's like my friends and my fans say, the power of Disney, the power of Beauty and the Beast in this incredible film.
Yeah. All right. Well, I see people nodding at me and saying, hey, here we go. God. So I'm sorry we couldn't get to more of your guys' questions. It's kind of weird with the lag time, so we were able to take on some of them. But maybe we'll be able to do a little more.
We can do some in this next segment.
Yeah. First of all, we want to thank you guys. That was wonderful. I'm sure you saw the stream of comments coming in.
We did.
Everybody is thoroughly enjoying it. And we will try to answer questions throughout the second part of the show. What we want to tell you all is we're going to take a quick 5-minute break just to reset here. Make sure you come back. We've got lots of exciting things, but when you're going to need to refresh your browser. Little technical issue, we're switching from the streaming platform that we use for part one and part two. So if you're having any issue connecting, just refresh your browser and we'll be back in about 5 minutes with lots of surprises and contest giveaways.
Thanks, bye.
It is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that we